We are so glad to have you here today. My name is Josh. I'm the senior pastor here at the Congo. And we are excited to have so many family members visiting today for our children's program. And it's going to be great. You know, Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." And today, the children are going to lead us in our service. We're not going to have normal songs like we normally have in the church. The children are going to be serving God and helping us to worship by the play that they're going to be putting on. So glad to have so many of you here for that. We have a few announcements I want to make before we get started. They're in your bulletin, several of them. We have a candlelight service on Christmas Eve at 5 p.m. Would love to have you bring family and friends to that as well. It'll be about an hour long, and so you can have dinner and stuff afterwards. So love to have you for that. Also, we are starting a prayer ministry through email, an email chain here at the church. And Chrissy McCleary, can you stand up just for a second? There's Chrissy right there. Her information is in the bulletin. If you have a prayer request, please send it along to Chrissy. The information is in the bulletin there for that. And thank you, Chrissy, for getting that going. We appreciate that. The program that's happening today during the service is also happening on Wednesday here at the church at 6:30 p.m. And afterwards, there will be a turkey dinner. If you want to come to the turkey dinner, you've got to sign up. You can either email the church office, or there is a sign-up sheet out here on the table. So please sign up so we know how many people to make food for. That's Clarice Hetzler needs that number, hopefully today or tomorrow. So if you're coming. Sunday school, we won't be having next week or the week after for children or adults, but we will have a time of fellowship just in the lobby here, coffee, donuts, things like that. So please still come if you're a Sunday school goer. We'd love to just hang out and spend time with each other there. We need some more ushers and greeters. So if you've never done that before, it's really easy. You hold the bulletins and people come in and you say, "Hey, welcome to our church. We're glad to have you," and shake their hand. And if you're nervous, we can even put you with another couple that has been experienced in that kind of thing before, shaking hands, handing out bulletins. You want to be an usher? No? Okay. We're going to put Janet's information right up here. Would you like a program? See, there's our advertisement. So you can reach out to Janet personally. She's the one that's handling that sign up. We would love to have you do that. It doesn't take much at all. Any other announcements that I'm forgetting right now? Which is I do have a couple, actually. So the poinsettias, if you want to turn those in today, that's a handout you have with your program. You can turn that into the offering plate or the office. Also, a new thing here, we have some prayer cards. This one didn't have them there. Oh, there it is. Prayer cards, you can see them here. If you have a prayer request, this is a part of the prayer ministry as well. You can fill that out, drop it in the offering plate. If it's confidential, you want to give it to me or Dan or Bruce, one of the pastors, you can check that box down there, and we will be praying for those prayer requests as well. So that's about it. Let's stand up and welcome each other, and thank you for being here today.
Yeah. have to be even better than last year's. Okay, what can I do to help? I have about 40 seconds. That's quick as done. This is the problem, and I have 15 more to do, and I just finished my study guide. Well, sweetie, it sounds like making good progress. Here, you need to carry the one, and then regroup. Hold on, I've got to get those.
Honey, I'm home.
Dad, I really need help on this. Hey, honey, glad you're home. How's your day? Dad, I really need help.
Okay. It was good, except now I have an interview for this promotion tomorrow, and we're having a Christmas party up. Okay, so you've got to carry the one, and then regroup. Oh, son, you've got to play that correctly.
Oh my goodness, I almost forgot. She has rehearsal tonight for the Christmas musical. Any chance you can take her? I've got to get these cookies done. The cookie party is tomorrow.
I can take her. I've got a few more gifts to buy.
Ooh, while you're out, can you get a gift for the gift exchange, please? Just not a fruitcake! Keep practicing, buddy. You can get it.
Down.
we decorate these? You are so good at that. Ooh, I love decorating cookies with you. Okay, I can take a little break from studying. Justin, you want to help?
Success! I made them all, got everything I need. Yes, I even got a fruit cake.
But Mom said don't get a fruit cake.
Did you finish your homework?
Almost. One of my questions is a survey. Could you all answer a question for me? It's easy. What is the best part of Christmas?
Well, that's an easy one.
Cookies!
What?
Cookies!
No!
Decorations!
Seriously?
Okay.
Maybe someone else can answer? Dad, what's your answer? So glad you're homing up decorating. Julie, how's car? Are you guys ready?
Miss Diane has so much more patience than I would ever imagine. I don't know how she does it. Jessica, did you finish your homework?
Almost. One of my questions is a survey. Could you all answer a question for me? It's easy. What is the best part of Christmas?
Well, that's an easy one.
Presents!
What?
Cookies!
No!
Decorations!
No, seriously?
Okay.
Maybe someone else can answer?
Hey, listen!
Dad, what's your answer?
Guys, listen!
Well, I love Christmas. It's the time to celebrate.
Hello, guys. It's Carolers. Listen!
Hey, look. It is Carolers. Why didn't you tell us before?
Thank you.
The nativity, everything is knocked over.
Shopping bags.
We were all too busy. But look at all these pieces. All of them parts of the real Christmas story.
I bet it was crazy busy then too.
Mary and Joseph had to travel a long way to Bethlehem.
Yes, even farther, and they had to walk.
And Mary was expecting a baby. And then when they got there, it was so busy in town that they didn't even have a place to stay.
And what about the shepherds? They were working that day. A stinky, smelly job.
Even stinky
and
dusty shoes?
Hey! I bet those shepherds were scared out of their minds when the angels started singing. Can you even imagine?
I bet it was beautiful, and loud, and crazy.
Thank you. This was the first census that has been taking place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town. So Joseph also went up to the town from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea and to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he was from the house and line of David. And he took Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
While they were there, the time came for her to have her baby. She had her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and laid him in a manger because there were no guest rooms available. And there were shepherds living on the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord was shown around them, and they were terrified.
The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring good news that will cause great joy. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. To you, the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloth lying in a manger."
Suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared, with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his heavenly rest."
When the angels had left them and gone back to heaven, the shepherds turned to one another and said, "Let's go see this thing in which has happened and which the Lord has told us about." So they went off to find Mary, Joseph, and baby Jesus in a manger. After the shepherds had heard all of it and seen him, they spread the word concerning all they had seen. And everyone who heard was amazed, but Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart.
The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which was just as they had been told.
Christmas is holy. Christmas is Jesus.
Don't go too far. Wow, that was amazing. Praise God for the children of our church, and so thankful for their performance today. And if you loved it, you can come back on Wednesday again at 6:30 and bring more. And we just want to say a few thank yous to those that have helped today. Jim Percy up there in the sound booth. Thank you, Jim. I don't know where he went. He's hiding up there. Chris Dietert, you can stand up right here. Chris Dietert put the stage together here. And last but not least, our co-directors, if Betsy and Dana could come in. Betsy Rush and Dana Teefee and Jessica. There's Jim. He's down there. Where's Dana? Is she coming? Somebody get Dana Teefee. We just have a little gift for you. And
Thank you. They did good, didn't they?
Yeah. We're going to wait for her. Did she go upstairs, you think?
No.
Oh, they're taking costumes off. Is Dana coming? No? She's getting the costumes. Oh, well, make sure you find everybody. Find Dana afterwards and say thank you to her for that. So, Betsy, thank you so much.
Yeah.
This is wonderful.
There she is,
Dana Teefee, everybody. Come on out here. We got a thank you for you. Yes. What a blessing. Thank you so much. All right. Good deal. Now, we are going to do the lighting of the Advent candle, so I'd like to invite the Frank and Mays family forward. This is a big multi-generational family here that we have, and they're going to light this candle. Hopefully, I won't put it out. Yeah, that was pretty good. Come on up here, guys. Who gets the lighter? You do? Okay. Nancy, you're trusted. And who gets the microphone first?
Granny.
Here you go, Granny. There we go.
Today we light the third candle, the candle of joy.
From the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, we read, "In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord.'"
In Isaiah 12, verses 4 through 6 read, "Give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples, proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be made known in all the earth. Shout and sing for joy, O inhabitant of Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel."
This is the third Sunday of Advent. The first candle reminded us of our hope in the light of Christ. The second candle reminded us of the peace of Christ. Today, as we light the third candle, we are reminded of the joy that is ours in Christ. Other feelings we may have, such as happiness, will wax and wane. They are temporary. But the joy that we have in what God has done for us in Christ is something we can always hold on to.
Let us pray. Lord, we rejoice that Jesus came to this earth as a baby. He lived the perfect life, died a sinner's death, and rose again. Help us to continually be reminded of the joy that comes from knowing Jesus. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you very much.
Please, somebody. Very cool. What a great time we had. The Frank Mays family. I could have sworn there were more of you. The pageant was a good time. I'm just glad there were only two casualties the whole way. That's a miracle. All right, we'll have our ushers come forward. As they make their way, let's go ahead and do the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, our choir will minister to us in song. Children are dismissed, and you may all be seated.
All right. Can you catch that? Anyone ages four to, what? Oh, wait. Pre-K to fourth grade?
Something.
Children's church. You're dismissed now. Sorry, we missed that beforehand. Okay. I want to ask you to pray for Pat Mervey, who has some bleeding going on that's been hard to stop. They were in Hawaii and had been to the emergency room twice. He's at home right now, but just please pray that he'd be able to get into the doctor tomorrow. And also, Linda Green fell again and hit her eye, and so she's in the hospital. But when I asked her, she said that she thought she'd be able to get out maybe in a day or two, so it wasn't too terrible, so thank God for that. And we are so thankful to have Colin here this morning with the Littles. Colin, we love you, brother. We love you. So let's just open with prayer. Jesus, thank you that you come down into our darkness to bring light in our struggles and weakness and brokenness and just the difficulties of life. In a crazy, busy, often difficult time, you are there and you call us to come to you in our weariness, our burdens, and to find rest in you because you are gentle and humble in heart.
Lord, we lift up to you Pat and Linda. Lord, we pray that you would bring healing to them. We just give them into your hands, Lord, and we also just pray for Colin, that you would bless him, Lord, with great healing from your hand. We just cry out to you for that, Lord. And others who are known by people sitting here today that need healing, God, those people know who they are right now. I pray that we would just lift them up to you and trust them into your care. Help us to trust you, God, but we do pray that you would be merciful, bring healing and help and comfort to those places that need it most during this time. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our sermon today is from Luke chapter 1. It's going to be verses 57 to 80, and I'll try and keep it short because I know I don't have much time. That'll be interesting to see how that goes for me. But as I was sitting here watching the children in the play, I had my video camera out, and so did my wife. She was sitting right down here, and who do you think I was videotaping? My children. Not, you know, I had the other kids in there, but I was making sure that my kids were in the center of that. And Julie actually told me, hey, you videotape Samuel over there, and I'll videotape Adelaide over here with the little kids. And so we had two cameras going on, two different angles. We'll be able to plug it into our TV later, and just amazing play it on there and watch the replay, right? Well, what's going on here in Luke is that the video camera of God is being focused and zoomed in upon his son. It's not ultimately about Zechariah or about Mary. It's about Jesus. It's not ultimately about John the Baptist, although this passage is about John the Baptist. And the title of the sermon is, His Name is John. Because Zechariah, John's father, in a moment, agrees with God finally. And in this passage, I want you to see something. Zechariah has had his mouth shut by God. Because in the passage a couple weeks ago, the angel comes to tell Zechariah that Elizabeth's going to have a baby. And he says, how shall I know this is going to happen? Zechariah was saying, God can only do things if I know how he's going to do it. Well, that's not how God operates. So the angel says, well, you're not going to be able to talk until your son is born. In the middle of this passage, God mercifully has met Zechariah. He closed his mouth so that he could open his heart, so that again he could open his mouth with agreeing with God and proclaiming the good news about Jesus. God is zooming in upon Jesus and his great work in this passage. So let's read from Luke chapter 1. You can follow along in your Bible, or we'll have the verses up there on the screen. Luke chapter 1, verses 57 to 80. It says this. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. And her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, when they came to circumcise the child, and they would have called him Zechariah after his father, but his mother answered, no, he shall be called John. And then they said to her, none of your relatives is called by this name. And they made signs to his father, inquiring what he wanted him to be called. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, his name is John. And they all wondered. And immediately his mouth was open and his tongue loosed, and he spoke, blessing God. This is the first time for 9 months that Zechariah has spoken. I know some of you maybe wish that there's people in your life that wouldn't speak for 9 months. But that's what's happened to Zechariah here. That's what's happened to him. And the way that you get your mouth shut by God is by disagreeing him and telling him that he can't do things because you said that you don't understand what he's doing. Well, God mercifully has shut Zechariah's mouth and so that his heart could be open to the truth of God. And I, you know, you think about what was Zechariah doing? He wasn't talking for 9 months. Well, I think he was in the scriptures. He was in the Bible. He was reading the Bible. Isn't that how it is? When God humbles us in our lives, that's when most people, including me, turn to God more fully. Because what comes out of his mouth next by the Holy Spirit is an amazing prophecy about Jesus that has been drawn from the Old Testament scriptures, and now he's proclaiming it by the Spirit. And so let's continue here. And fear came on all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about through all the hill country of Judea. And all who heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, what then will this child be? For the hand of the Lord was with him. And that's John the Baptist it's speaking of. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. the oath that he swore to our father Abraham to grant us, that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child, John the Baptist, grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day of his public appearance to Israel. This is God's word. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God will stand forever. What's going on here? Well, there's a man who is a religious professional that I can relate to, because that's who Zechariah was. He was a priest, and he had been serving in the temple, and an angel had appeared to him and said, your wife's going to have a baby, and he's going to be the prophet that's going to prepare the way for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Messiah. And Zechariah, who was full of Bible knowledge, he was full of professional training to be a ministry leader, just like me and Dan and Bruce and others in this world, he did not have the right knowledge that he needed in the moment, because he disagreed with God. If you go back and compare this to Mary, up on the screen, there's some verses here between Mary and Zechariah that we'll look at. If you see Zechariah, what he said in this moment, Zechariah said to the angel, how shall I know this? For I'm an old man and my wife is advanced in years. And if you look at Mary's response when God told Mary that she was going to have Jesus and she wasn't married yet, she hadn't known a man yet, she says, how will this be since I'm a virgin? Do you see the difference there? Zechariah demands to know how it's going to happen. Mary says, well, it's going to happen, but how? She doesn't demand. She agrees that God's going to do this. She just is wondering how. And so what's happening here is we see that an unwed teenage mother from the wrong side of the tracks, which was like Nazareth, that's where she's from. I mean, I don't know what you think of when you think of Nazareth around here. What would people from Quincy think of when they're in their judgmental spirit looking down on others? Maybe, I hope this doesn't hurt anybody's feelings. Hull. I do not mean that in the wrong spirit. I just know how we all are. But we're from Quincy. But you know what people from maybe New York City or Washington, D.C., they would say, Quincy, Illinois. How can anything good come from Quincy, Illinois? Well, what's going on here is God is raising up a humble servant of his, Mary, from Nazareth, an unwed teenage mother. And what's going on here that Luke is actually doing is he's exposing and showing how Mary actually knows more than the trained professional priest from Jerusalem, Zechariah. Do you see this here? What God is saying here, and what God is saying here is that, you know, it's not about all the training and all the Bible knowledge. All that stuff matters, but if you don't trust God, it doesn't matter. Just having the right answers about God is not enough. If you don't have a personal relationship with him where you say, he can do anything, and I trust him, and he's good, I don't know how it's going to happen, but God's going to do it. And we see here that Zechariah and Mary, the next comparison, Mary, what she says after the angel tells her, well, it's the Holy Spirit's going to cause Jesus to be conceived in your womb, and then he's going to be born, and you're going to name him Jesus. What does she say? She says, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. Mary says, I trust the word of God. It's so much higher, so much more powerful, so much better than my word. I trust God's word. Mary is entering back into a moment before in the Garden of Eden they fell into sin. They said, God, we trust our word more than your word. And Satan said, did God really say that you're going to die? And they trusted the serpent in that moment. Well, what we see here in the faith of Mary, a humble servant of God, an unwed teenage mother, is that she has more Bible knowledge than the trained priest. And she says, I'm God's servant. Let it be according to me according to your word. Well, Zechariah, he comes around. And that's the hope for us, because I know you and I, we can all relate to Zechariah, trying to stay in control of our lives, demanding that we have an answer as to why God does what he does, and then struggling with it, struggling with doubt, discouragement. Well, God comes with tender mercy to Zechariah. He shuts his mouth, but it's a very gracious and tender thing, because you see that John the Baptist still comes from his family. It's about grace. God has humbled Zechariah to agree with God. But look at what Zechariah says, and he asks for a writing tablet. He says, his name is John. And they all wondered, and immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed, and he spoke, blessing God. You see, what happened is this man whose heart was full of thinking that he was in control was emptied of that notion that it was about him and what he knew. And he was filled up with trusting that God knew what he was doing, that God could do anything. His heart was filled up with a new birth from above of the gospel, the good news. His heart was emptied of trusting in himself and human knowledge and human effort, and was filled up with trusting in God's knowledge and God's new goodness and God's effort. And he opened his mouth, and it was overflowing with praise about Jesus. Because if you see here in this prophecy, and this is the way I want to wrap up what I have here, is that this prophecy is all about Jesus. We're going to cycle through the same ones that we read here. I want you to see this. I've highlighted some of these. The visitation, Jesus is the visitation of God in human history. He is the redemption of God in human history. We have that in verse 68. In verse 69, he is the horn of salvation for us. In verse 70, he is the one who spoke by the mouth of the prophets. In verse 71, he is our salvation from our enemies. In verse 72, he is the mercy promised to our fathers. And then he is the holy covenant of God that God has made to us. He's the fulfillment of the Abrahamic covenant, as Jesus becomes the one who fulfills the covenant on our behalf. Jesus is the one that enables God to serve him without fear, enables us to serve God without fear. Jesus is the holiness and righteousness of God. And then if you go to verse 77, Jesus is salvation. The person of salvation who knows us in all of our struggles, all of our sin, and loves us and forgives us and changes us from within. So like Zechariah, our mouths can be opened because we have seen Jesus and Jesus lives in our hearts. Jesus is the forgiveness of sins. He took all of our sin upon himself on the cross 2,000 years ago. For a Christian, our judgment day was 2,000 years ago. When Jesus comes back, it's not going to be judgment day if you're a Christian. It's wedding day. It's wedding day. Isn't that great? That's how we serve God without fear, because Jesus took all of our sins away. Jesus is the tender mercy of God, and I love how it says this, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Jesus is the sunrise. He's the light in the darkness. I don't know what kind of darkness you're dealing with or the shadow of death that you're feeling today and experiencing in your life, but I'll tell you one thing. What God's word revealed that he wants you to trust this morning is that your answer is found in Jesus. He's the sunrise that you need from the long night that you're going through. He is the light of salvation. He is the hope of everyone. And the words from Isaiah chapter 42, I think, are important here. Isaiah 42, verses 1 to 7. I've chosen some of these verses because I want to show you how Zechariah from the Bible saw that Jesus was the fulfillment of these prophecies. Isaiah 42, it says this, "Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit on him." It's talking about Jesus. What is he like? "A bruised reed he will not break, and a faintly burning wick he will not quench." A few verses later, it says this, "I am the Lord, I have called you." And it's speaking about Jesus. "I've called you, Jesus, in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and keep you, and I will give you as a covenant for the people, a light for the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison those who sit in darkness." What's the dungeon that you're facing today? How are you sitting in darkness today? My greatest encouragement to you is to come to Jesus and hear him saying to you, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever is believing into me, rivers of living water will flow out of his belly. That's what it says. The place from your heart where lack of trust in God, running after the idols of this world. It says when we believe in Jesus, he gives us the Holy Spirit to change us from within. And then the water of God, the goodness of God, just like with Zechariah, it fills us up and flows out of our hearts, through our mouths, through our actions, to quench the thirst of others in this world. That's what Jesus is doing in this. That's what Jesus is doing. In a few moments, we're going to have our bell choir play, and I want you to think about this as they play. The gospel is ringing in this world. Do you have ears to hear it? The gospel is ringing. What is ringing in your heart? What do you think is going to fill the void that you're running to, seeking other things other than Jesus to deal with your life? Are you like Zechariah? Are you a religious person who thinks that all of your Bible knowledge and that you have the right answers, but in that, have you forgotten that God wants you to come to him personally and trust him? Maybe you don't count yourself a religious person here today. You came for another reason. Well, know that the playing field is completely level. And when Jesus said, "Judge not, lest ye be judged," why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye when you have a log in your own eye? First, take the log out of your own eye, and then you'll be able to see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. What he meant by that is that your sin to you should look big. So that when you come to others, you can come with the same gentle, tender mercy that God comes to us. None of us deserves God to forgive us or be merciful to us. Just like Zechariah didn't deserve it. God could have rejected Zechariah, but he didn't. He gave him grace. He shut his mouth for a while. And I, more than anybody, can listen to that. I need to listen better, not talk so much. But what is God saying to you today? What is he saying to you? How do you need to come to him? As you hear the bell choir play to us, to end our time today, think about the gospel that's ringing and how God is ringing in the hearts of those that trust him instead of themselves.
Thank you.
Please stand for the benediction. May you know that just as Zechariah received the tender mercy and grace of God, that is offered for you today also as a free gift in relationship with him. So may the love of God the Father and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Thanks for being here today.